Lord, this is your plan. These are your ways. We pray, Lord, that you would proclaim them very clearly to us, and they would have the impact and effect on us you desire them to have, so that we might live righteously and godly and soberly in this world. Lord, awaken us from anything we're sleeping in, and put to death and put to slumber anything that's living through us that shouldn't be there. And Lord, thank you for putting away sin for us, Jesus, because we were enslaved. And I thank you that we no longer have to be enslaved to sin. We might stumble, but we know we have a new master. We have a new nature. We have a new spiritual palate, things that taste good to us now. And we crave, we hunger, we thirst for righteousness. That's just a work of your spirit in our lives. Lord, just that all of us in this room are here, it's a miracle, because we were a bunch of ragamuffins and we were going our own way. And Lord, you just like called each one of us in a unique way. We didn't all get saved at the same age, in the same place, in the same way. But you delivered us like a midwife would deliver a baby. You allowed the contractions of our lives to open us up, so that then we would crown and come forth and we'd be born of your spirit. Lord, this is your doing, and it's marvelous in our eyes. And we ask, Lord, as we look and we continue to look into this beautiful book, that, Lord, you would instruct us and you would teach us and you would enlighten us and you establish us in your truth. We lift up those who live in our households there, because we have you, and we have these ministering spirits that are there to tend to us. And I thank you that no one in here is alone, that you will never leave us, you will never forsake us, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. Hebrews 10, 1 says, "For the law, having a shadow of the good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never, with these same sacrifices which they offer continually, year by year, make those who approach perfect." So now the writer of Hebrews and the Holy Spirit comes back to the law again, to these Hebrew believers, these Jewish believers, because the law was so upheld, so venerated, so studied. Even today when you go to Israel and they carry the scrolls and they kiss them and they put them and lock them away and they handle them with such care. It goes back and says, but the law couldn't do it. The law was not bad. We learn here that the law had a shadow, was a shadow of good things to come, not the image of the very things. Now shadows, a lot of people think of shadows as something dark. They're like, ooh, you know, this and that, you know. But do you know, like, when a painter, and some of you are painters, they learn how to paint shadows, because shadows are what bring attention to the main subjects of whatever they're painting. The shadows are absolutely important to be able to display light the way it's supposed to be, or to give something a three dimension behind it. When they paint the shadow behind, you see where it's placed in the painting. And our God, when he gives the shadows, the law, it's meant to really showcase the main subject of the story, which is the Messiah, which is God's Son, Jesus Christ, who is coming. Think of these shadows of the Old Testament more as a foreshadow of something that was going to come. The law, it says, cannot, with the sacrifices, make people perfect, cannot do anything to make us right with God. Law shows us what is right, but law doesn't make us right. Law tells us standards. And you know, God's people were supposed to be a testimony to the Gentiles and surrounding nations that there was a real God who knew what life was really all about. And so these laws were to govern them in the midst of chaos among the Philistines and among Egypt and among Assyria, where they were sacrificing their children to Molech, or they were involved in hideous sexual practices or eating things that could contaminate them. He gave them these laws to show people that he was governing the nation. The law was supposed to be more of a testimony that there's a lawgiver, more than that the people are righteous because they keep the law. You know, it's just like now that those of us who are saved by his work, when we live a certain way, it's supposed to show the world that God is right. when they go, wow, like things work out for you in that area. Well, yeah, like how come you never get fired? Well, I don't steal from my employer and I show up on time, and it kind of gets rid of some unnecessary trauma in my life. And like, oh, well, you're so righteous. Well, no, I'm not righteous, but the law is. The law is righteous. I'm not. I fall short. But I have a standard because God is a righteous God who gives the law. And that's why we don't have to be ashamed of the law. We aren't saved to live recklessly. We're saved to glorify the lawgiver. But now we have no fear of judgment, and we can try and step out in things. You know, sometimes if people think the law would save them, they could end up just going to a monastery, hiding in a room, and saying, if I just sit here and I don't do anything, then maybe I'll get to heaven. But God said, no, you're the salt of the earth, the light of the world. Go out there and do your best and seek me and live for me and glorify me. And then when we mess up, he gets glory too. And I've shared that with you before, the whole story with that. When I lied, when I was a new Christian, I lied to that non-Christian because I wanted to witness to him, and he was a drug person, and I wasn't, so I'm like acting like I was used to use drugs, and I never did. I was a brand new Christian, but I thought, he won't, you know, and I went back, and the Lord said, you lied to him. You lied, and you need to apologize to him. I go, oh, no, that's so bad, because, like, I'm a Christian, and he knows I lied, and then I'm going to ruin the whole thing, to go to hell, it's all my fault. You know, you're a Christian, you're all thinking it's all on you, because you don't really understand yet, and he goes, you need to do this. I said, you know what? I'm not going to worry about it. I need to do what you're telling me to do because I'm following you. I went over to Jim and I said, Jim, I'm so sorry. I go, I lied to you. I said, I was over there cleaning the shake machine because I worked at McDonald's. And I said, and the Holy Spirit told me that I lied to you and you don't deserve that. And I sinned against you. I'm so sorry. And then he kind of looked at me and then he walked over and he said, what do you mean the Holy Spirit spoke to you? I go, he told me that you hear the Holy Spirit? I totally sinned, and God, like, totally used it, you know, like, because there's forgiveness, and I wasn't preaching myself as righteous, and sometimes when we blow it, we go back to our non-Christians and say, I'm sorry. They say, oh, I could live like that. Sometimes we act so holy, people think they can never come to Christ. If we blow it and admit it, people say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm wrong, and God forgives me, and then they say, oh, that's what that, yes, we walk with the Lord, we learn, we grow, there's forgiveness with the Lord, and you can grow in things. And people say, I can do that. I can grow. I can't be perfect, but I can grow. These sacrifices go on and on. If they were able to take away sins, they wouldn't have to keep going in every year. When the law was given, even just the Ten Commandments, in that very chapter of Exodus 20, turn to Exodus 20. This is where, and of course, the law is much more than the Ten Commandments, but let's just look at that aspect. When the rules were given in Exodus 20, the Lord already knew we were going to blow it when he gave them. Look at Exodus 20, 24. Right after he says, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do this, and da da da. Acts 20, 24. In the same chapter that the rules were given, Exodus 20, 24, the Lord says, an altar of earth you shall make for me, and you shall sacrifice on it your burnt offerings, your peace offerings, your sheep, and your oxen. He gives all the rules and goes, and I know you're not really going to do it all the time, and you're going to have to do the sacrifice like that fast. He says, this is what you got to do. Now, what's really neat is he says, in every place where I record my name, I'm going to come to you, and I will bless you. Exodus 20, 25, listen up. He says, if you make me an altar of stone, not earth, or from the earth, you shall not build it of hewn stone. Now, we don't use this word hewn a lot. It's a good Scrabble word. Hewn stone, that's when somebody like takes stone and cuts it out and shapes it, chisels it, you know, makes it fit real nicely. Because you're not allowed to use a piece of stone that your tool shaped for my altar. He goes, for if you use your tool on it, you have profaned it. It was already saying, when you're trying to get right with me, when you're going to go, I'll do more good than bad, I'll learn Greek, I'll become a Calvinist, so, you know, whatever it is, you know, he says, if you lift your tool on that altar, I don't accept it. And just like when Christ did the sacrifice, you can't do it. I can't do it. And he says, no, you have to just take stones that I've allowed to form by, you know, erosion and my rain. You didn't do anything to make it. You take what I've given you and offer it to me. Then it's acceptable. And he says in verse 26, nor, Exodus 20, 26, nor, I love this one, nor shall you go up by steps to my altar, that your nakedness may not be exposed on it. Now you're all going, why do you love that? Because steps, he doesn't want us to have steps to get right with God. He doesn't want us, well, once I do this, and then I do this, and then I do this. They weren't allowed to build steps up to the sacrifices. You know, they build an altar out there in the wilderness. They weren't allowed to make it where they, and also, we talked about this before, it would be a hill. It would be earth, and then they do the stones. And it was a hill, you had to lean in towards the altar as you ascended. Steps, you could stop for a minute and just kind of rest in who you are and be kind of parallel and like stopping your ascent. But when it was like this, you were leaning in, and that's what we're doing now. And he's the sacrifice, we're leaning in. We're going towards, we're ascending the hill of the Lord. We're always leaning in, not striving and taking steps. We're just leaning into the Lord. Wake up in the morning, Lord, I love you. Pray for food, thank you for this food. Go to Bible study, I need this. We're driving, Lord, just put on worship music. We're leaning, we're always leaning in. We're not working, we're leaning. We're inclining to the Lord. And he says, don't make steps for these altars. Don't be lifting your tool. Because I'm the one. I'm going to provide that sacrifice. Even the sacrifices that they would make and the altars they would make in the wilderness were a foreshadow. The law was a shadow of Christ coming. And I love that. And it says, and you know what's interesting, it's a little side note, is in Israel, there's the Temple Mount. And when they built the temple, they weren't supposed to have the sound of any tools building the temple. That was one of the things in the scriptures, just like this altar. So what they still did, they made stones, but they went to a quarry across the Kidron Valley, and they dug out stones, and they'd use hammers and everything like that, and then they would bring it over the Temple Mount, and they would assemble it. So it was quiet when they were assembling. It was quietness and the effort. But out there, outside of the gates, over on this quarry area is where you'd hear the work done. And that is the exact area now that certain people believe where the skull, the place of the skull is. That Christ was, his work was outside the city because he was doing the work. And you could hear the hammer putting the nails into his hands right in the quarry area where they would have been taking the stones and doing things like that. Wow, is right. You're like, it's just so amazing that God had the same plan from Genesis to Revelation, and even uses where he's at to teach us that this was his plan. This isn't created by man. This isn't a church. This isn't a ritual. This isn't something that man has come up with. We would never come up with this. I could never come up with this. You know, I mean, what cult could come up with this? This is in the mind of God where everything lines up. From saying, don't lift up your tool on that stone. Don't put steps when you approach me. And the fact that he put sacrifice immediately following the Ten Commandments showed that he knew the law itself was not going to make us right with him. Verse 2, Hebrews 10, 2. For then, if this had made it right, if the law made it right, the high priest going in, verse 2, then would they not have ceased to be offered? I mean, wouldn't it just stop if that's all there was? For the worshippers, once purified, would have had no more consciousness of sins. If that's all that was needed, then they wouldn't have to keep going on. But there's a sense of doing something to acknowledge and to realize that I'm still not clean. There was no cleansing. There was a covering that would happen. And verse 3, the one in verse 3, it says, but in those sacrifices, there's a reminder of sins every year. The high priest, even offering the sacrifice for sins committed in ignorance, just still had to remember, wow, there's sins committed in ignorance. So it was always bringing attention to sin, attention to the sin, attention to the sin. You know, sometimes there's a false humility in bringing attention to our own sin that God doesn't really want us to talk about. And in Colossians, it talks about teach not, touch not, do not. And sometimes certain churches will get into this holiness doctrine. And it's all about yourself and how you're changing. And it's spiritual pride, but it's the opposite end. It's like beating yourself up all the time. So focus on self. We aren't worthy. I heard J. Vernon McGee this week say, I hear these people going before the Lord and say, oh, we're not worthy. And we're, well, of course you're not. You know? He said, why don't you just tell him he is? You know, just like, why are you focusing on you? And tell him you are worthy to receive all glory and honor. And he already knows that. He made us righteous. It says that there's a remembrance and a reminder of that sin every year. Remember Adam and Eve, when they sinned, they didn't get forgiveness and cleansing. They didn't get cleansing. They got covering. They got covering. They got the animal skin. But again, it was still a foreshadow because there was blood. There was shedding of blood. Remember, even Cain, when he brought his sacrifice, there was no blood. It was just fruits and vegetables and stuff. And he thought, well, this is my stuff. This is what I want to offer. This is what I think God should accept. And of course, his brother brought, you know, an animal. And there was going to be blood. And the Lord required blood. Verse 4, but it says, it's not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away sin. So this was happening time and time again. And I want to remind you that these animals that were sacrificed, did they volunteer for this? Pick me. You know, they're probably just thinking, oh, where are we going? You know? And they didn't do it of their own will. But remember, Christ offered himself up. The Lamb of God offered himself up. I mean, was it really painful for a high priest to offer the blood of a bull or goat? No, sweat off his back. You know, I mean, a little gross, a little ugly, but it wasn't his life. But our high priest offered himself and went through the pain that he went through. 2 Peter 1, let's go to 2 Peter chapter 1. Remember, it cannot take away. Second Peter 1:9. And remember, it says there, it's not possible blood of bulls and goats could take away sin. And the need for cleansing is still here in every human life. And everybody knows that they're sinners, even if they don't call it that. They have like personality flaws. They have struggles. They have their own weaknesses. They'll call it sin, but it's sin. Or they've been injured by someone's actions, or it's sin. And everybody knows that they need a remedy. And so if they don't have the cleansing work of the blood of Christ, everyone goes towards covering. Everybody does. Take a pill, drink, focus on your education, looking good, something to try to cover this ugliness that I have to deal with. But we're supposed to remember that we are cleansed, and then we as believers will not fall into false comforters, and we won't start trying to cover ourselves. We'll be honest and transparent. We won't be arrogant. We don't mind admitting we've done something wrong. You know, when you know that you're accepted based on the merit of Christ alone, and your marriage is much better because you're not defensive. You're like, oh, shoot, I'm sorry. Because every day you just know that I'm a blow it and I want to be more like Christ. So when someone confronts you, you don't get defensive. But if we get defensive, we are forgetting that we are cleansed. In 2 Peter 1:9, it says, for he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Now, this is talking about a list right before this of genuine fruit that was supposed to be in a believer. And he's saying if fruit isn't coming from your life, you've probably forgotten that you're cleansed, and you're going back to works and law. You have expectations on other people. You're going to control everybody. You're moved away from the hope of the gospel. You're still saved. But you're living a very frustrated existence, unnecessarily living that frustrated. You've forgotten. You're short-sighted. You've forgotten that you are cleansed from your old sins. And because of that, you're trying to do righteousness. Later in the book of Peter, it talks about these false teachers that come in and start laying the law on them. And they were really open to that because they forgot they were cleansed. And that's why we need to take communion. That's why we need to wake up in the morning and we need to stand in that forgiveness and that cleansing that Christ has bought us. It keeps us. It's our very foundation. for everything else that happens. If we get moved away from the hope of the gospel, we usually end up in really ridiculous, weird religions and theologies and practices. And if you've been in the Lord long enough and you've been around enough people, you've watched people do that. They've moved away. They've forgotten that they were cleansed. And maybe even there's a pattern in their life that they don't like, and so they try this and they try that, but they have to stand. When we are cleansed, we tend to walk clean. When we know we are cleansed, we might struggle, but we struggle with his help and with his favor, and we always have much more victory over sin when we know we're doing it with God rather than trying to do it for God. We're no match for our sin. We're just not. I mean, how y'all doing with that? Trying to fight who you are. Have you ever tried to be good? Shoot. That is like really frustrating, isn't it? Today, I'm not going to snap at my kids. You know, I'm not. Now, you don't say, Lord, I pray you fill me and give me grace to. I thank you that I'm forgiven. Yesterday was another day. I snapped at them. I'm sorry. But today, fill me with your spirit. And you and me together, we're going to get through this. And he changes you. I know recently I was in a Bible study, and I got really dealt with by the Lord. I looked at a verse. I said, I am nowhere near that. Like, I kind of want to just leave and just cry because I said, oh, that is like so far away from who I am at this point of my transformation. And I said, well, I don't need to be afraid to look at that. I need to look at it in all honesty and say, I am not there. And I thank you, Lord, that you've revealed that to me. And I thank you that you wouldn't have shown me that unless you wanted to change me like that. And then I wrote this whole thing to him this morning. I said, I wrote it all out, the whole verse. And I said, help me be this and do this and do this and help me even recognize that. I don't even know if I recognize that. And Lord, I thank you that you're going to transform me. You're taking me from glory to glory. I didn't have to walk away. Oh, I can't keep Bible studying because I might have to that verse. You know, I just go, well, you know, this is a good thing. And I like to think about people that are good in certain areas that I'm not. Because I like to look at a verse and I go, oh, I'm not like that. Oh, but she's like that. Well, that's how it looks in the flesh. Like, I love to enjoy the example of my other brothers and sisters. I compare myself in a good way as far as like, well, they can do it. I can do it. And I can see it manifest in the flesh in them. And I go, oh, that's so good. I admire that. Thank you, Lord, that I had a chance to witness obedience to that in this person. And I can even pray like, oh, thank you for giving me people that show me that. And I thank you that you want to change me. But I don't want to forget that I'm cleansed from my old sin. Just because sometimes you hit a doozy and you go, oh, I'm so far away from that. How will I ever change? And the devil goes, yeah, you really haven't at all. Yeah, I guess I haven't. You know, no, he's the accuser of our brethren. You say, wow, I'm nowhere near this, but I thank you that you cleanse me from my sins, from my past. I am a new creation in Christ. And all things have become new. And you're changing me from glory to glory. I don't want to forget. I don't want to be short-sighted, even to blindness. If we forget that we have been cleansed, he's put away the sin, we will seek to establish our own righteousness. And we will establish everyone else's as well. You should be treating me like this. Well, if you were a godly husband, well, if you were a young boy seeking not, you know, probably, I'm telling you, when we are harsh on people, we have moved away from realizing we've been cleansed from our own sin. And we have to swim in that because we extend that grace to people when we are swimming in that grace ourselves. In Romans 10, 1, Paul says about Israel, Romans 10, 1, Romans, and of course, is written mainly to non-Jews. It's a super long book explaining the same things that are in Hebrews, but from like a Gentile standpoint. Romans 10, 1, he says, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. Verse 2, for I bear them witness, they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. Verse 3, for they, being ignorant of God's righteousness, meaning not aware that it's in Christ that we're made righteous, God's standard has to be this eternal blood is what's going to take care of our eternal debt and make us live eternally in heaven because he did it up there. It says, verse 3, they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. When we submit to the righteousness of God, we stop trying to establish our own righteousness. if I have more devotions, if I do this, if I do that. We go, no, no. I am going to submit to the righteousness of God. I'm going to believe that I'm forgiven. I'm going to believe that I'm right with God. I'm going to believe that my sin has been put away. I'm going to believe that my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm going to believe that I have a mediator, a new covenant, and I have access into that throne room. I'm not going to allow my choices to identify me in His sight more than the actions and deeds of Jesus Christ on the cross at Calvary and His resurrection from the dead. That's way louder and way more permanent than me, you know, speeding a painter. It's just stronger. And this might be wrong, and I still have to say I'm sorry, and I have to learn to follow those rules, but that's not what makes God not like me. You know, God loves me, and He's for me. And it says in verse 4 of Romans 10, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes, not who does this and joins Calvary Chapel, comes to Marion's Bible study. No, it's for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone who believes. And this just really marriages well with Hebrews 10. And they're both chapter 10. So I always feel like Romans 10, Hebrews 10, 10 commandments. You remember 10 commandments? Hebrews 10, Romans 10. Okay, good. Verse 5. Therefore, when he, Jesus, came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you have prepared for me. And burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin, you had no pleasure. Now, this is in Hebrews 10, 5. Are you all there? Okay. Yes. Now, this is Jesus talking. This is he, when he came to the world. And it says in verse 7, then I said, behold, I have come, the volume of the book is written of me, to do your will, O God. Now this is taken, he's quoting from Psalm chapter 40, verse 6. Now I want to show you something so that you don't get tripped up when your friends that love to show you contradictions of the Bible want to show you this. I'm going to teach you something. Go to Psalm 40, verse 6. Psalm 40, verse 6. This is what's being quoted, kind of. So sacrifice and offering you did not desire. My ears you have opened. Burnt offering and sin offering you did not require. Verse 7 of Psalm 40. Then I said, behold, I come. In the scroll of the book it is written of me. Verse 8. I delight to do your will, O my God, and your law is within my heart. Okay, now. In Hebrews, it's kind of quoting from Psalm 40. Now, who does he say in the book of Hebrews was speaking this? Jesus is that he came. So Jesus said this. And you will not tell them Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John. It isn't. So does that mean Jesus didn't say it? Did Jesus only say the things that are in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? No. The Bible says in John 21, 25, there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself couldn't contain the books that would be written. So he said things that were not written in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That doesn't mean you're supposed to go to some weird cult and read the lost sayings of Jesus, okay? What I'm saying is, if this is quoted in the book of Hebrews that Jesus said this. It just isn't in the Gospels. The writer of Hebrews heard it. The Holy Spirit had him write this down. Now, in this psalm, it's a psalm of David. It was about a king who would sit forever on the throne. In Psalm 40, it does not have the phrase, a body you have prepared for me. He's misquoting scripture. Never. Jesus is the word made flesh. Anything he says is scripture. It is scripture. But Jesus added this other part to explain, I'm the sacrifice. Because the verse in Psalm 40 says, burnt offering and sin offering you did not require. But he says, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, meaning the blood of bulls and goats, but a body you prepared for me. He quoted this. He said this to whoever was there at the time that he said this. He was kind of saying, if you read Psalm 46, I'm the fulfillment of that. I am going to be the Lamb of God. These sacrifices and burnt offerings will not cleanse sin, but I will. I came to do your will, O God. Verse 8. Hebrews 10, 8. Previously saying, sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings, and offerings for sin you did not desire, nor have pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law, verse 9, and he said, behold, I've come to do your will, O God. So he quotes the Psalm 40, and he's saying, look, all of this about sacrifices that you don't want, which, you know, the Jewish people are like, what do you don't want? Because you're supposed to do them. But he's not saying he didn't want them. He's saying that isn't really the requirement for what man needs. It's a shadow of what's coming. It's introducing, it's the opening band. It's saying, this is coming. And he says, I have come to do your will, O God. At the end of that verse there, in Hebrews 10, 9, it says, he takes away the first so that he may establish the second. It's in the Old Testament, and in Christ we understand what these things meant. And things that look like contradictions are actually fulfillments. They're like the missing jigsaw piece, puzzle piece. You know, they're like, what is all this blood and labor and veil and ugh. And it's all supposed to be pointing to the coming of the Messiah, because we're a little slow, you guys. You know, we are a little dense, and we get a little high-minded, and we start deciding in the sphere of our understanding, and God had to use like 4,000 years to explain things to us. We're not going to go into this today, but the first covenant came before the law. It was with Abraham, and it was a covenant by faith. It was the very first covenant, and there was no law yet, and it was with blood, and that's a whole other neat study. I'm sure we'll probably hit it somewhere here in Hebrews, but it was never, the law came later to govern them as a people, to speak to the world that God is the lawgiver. And these are things we have to understand, and we have to realize that all those tangible things, those shadows, the things that we see are meant to show heavenly things and to point to the Messiah. Matthew 5:17, Jesus said, don't think I came to destroy the law and the prophets. I didn't come to destroy, but to fulfill. I'm the one who's going to make sense of why you've been doing all this for all these years. I'm here to fulfill that. Verse 10 of Hebrews 10. By that will we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Remember he quoted Psalm 40 where he said, a body you have prepared for me? Well, I am sure that these disciples did not get it. I know that because the Bible says they didn't get it. So later, they go, oh, and then they remembered that Jesus said, you know, like, oh, you know, they didn't really understand that his whole mission was to come and be a sacrifice. You know, they were hoping, you know, Peter, I'm sure, thought, oh, we're going to get rid of the Romans. And then you've got, like, people that are kind of into the esoteric, like, ooh, these are neat teachings, see ye first, the, you know, writing songs, and that all is great, but the bottom line was, he came in the flesh to be the sacrifice, and you know, we could listen to Jesus' teachings all day, we could do everything that he does, and we're still going to go to hell, unless he had gone to the cross for our sins, and that's why we preach Christ and him crucified, not just righteousness, morality, or republicanism, or whatever. We have to preach Christ and him crucified. Don't be ever ashamed of the gospel. Never be afraid to tell someone, do you know that Christ died for you? And remember, I've told you this before, if you're a little shy or a little embarrassed, or your personality really doesn't, I mean, you wouldn't even sell Amway that way. You know, it's just not your personality. Remember, I told you, you can always preach the gospel in prayer. I'm told you, it really works. You just say, oh, is there something I can pray for you for? Most people have something, I'm like, yeah, I have cancer. And then you pray, and then you say, and I thank you, Lord, that you died on the cross for our sins, that you rose from the dead. You can just pray that, and they can still hear the truth, but maybe you're not a confrontational person. It's like this. Sometimes I'm not into it, or like I'm in a business, or I'm feeling like I don't know how to really just bring it up. So I just ask for prayer, and then I just preach the gospel through the prayer. And I did just the other day, I was on the phone yesterday with a representative at Kaiser, and we were talking about some things, and she actually started crying. It was kind of a neat moment on the phone with her. And then I said, well, can I just pray for you, you know? And she said, yes. And then I think she's a believer. I think it was, she goes, I just can't believe I'm having this conversation. It was one of those holy moments where I was just trying to get a refund on my copayment, and we were just talking, and I got it. And so I had just told her, I said, you know, you have such a difficult job. I said, because you're not working retail. You're not working with somebody returning shoes. You're talking about healthcare, cancer, treatment. I go, I can't even believe you have this job. Like, because I wouldn't want a job to call people back about healthcare. It would just be really hard, you know? And she goes, it is really hard. She said, and I'm empathetic. She goes, which is really harder because I'm trying to care for the people, but then I have to represent the company. And I go, you know, you have to see God. I told her, I said, you need to ask God for the ability to care for people and still execute appropriate judgment. I said, this is just, I do pray. I go, oh, you do? And I told her, and people have this strange idea that they're never going to die, and they wouldn't die if insurance would just do what it's supposed to do. I said, but you know, in Adam, we all die. I told her, I said, and you're dealing with people who are trying to save their lives because they're not prepared for death. So you've got, like, you know, radical. She goes, yes. She goes, that's it. You know, I said, I know. I go, and I love my doctors, but my trust is not in my doctors. I'm glad God uses them. But if I die, I know where I'm going. And I don't need to fight as if I'm afraid to die. You know, I fight because I love to live. But I don't need to fight in a way that I'm afraid to die. And we ended up praying. And I wasn't sure she was saved or not, because a lot of people say they pray. And so I gave her the gospel in the prayer. You know, I said, can I just pray for you in your job? She said, yes. And so I started praying for her. And I said, Lord, I thank you that you died for our sins. And I started praying, thank you that it was within me. We must be born again. And we cannot have a life without a new nature, without you within us. And I just prayed, her name was Heather. And I said, I just prayed for Heather that she would be fully convinced that you're her Savior and her Lord. She'd have a life with your strength and your authority. You know, and we got done. And she just said, I just can't lose this conversation. And I go, I know the Lord's in it, huh? I told her, because I felt his presence too. I said, I know, this is so neat, huh? And she said, yeah. But that's why when we preach Christ crucified, we're like, you know, Jesus died for you? No, like, you know, like, I'm just trying to get a burger. Goes, you know? But when we say, can I just pray for you? We can talk about Christ's sacrifice. Maybe if you're just kind of a I know some of you are real bold and you have no problem with it, but some of us, sometimes just, it's awkward. And it's a way, and especially when you pray, you're inviting the presence of the Lord. And, you know, as soon as you, sometimes when you even pray for a non-believer and they hear your access, they're like, gosh, she talks like she really knows him. I want to know him like that. And it's not arrogancy. You're humbling yourself in prayer. And you're calling on the name of the Lord. It's not contending with someone about doctrine. You're bringing them into the presence of the Lord. And you're preaching Christ crucified. It was going to be, we were going to be sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. John 6:38. Jesus said, I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. I delight to do thy will, he said. You know, can we echo that? I mean, that is just such a great example to us. I remember one time the Lord was dealing with me on something, and I didn't really want to do it. I remember, okay. And I obey, because you deserve obedience. And then the Lord goes, that's not delighting to do my will. I go, what is it? I go, what is the stinking attitude I have? He goes, wait, I don't want you to just do my will. I want you to delight to do my will. I go, oh, that'll make it much easier if I just delight to do your will instead of like, oh. And I started like delighting to do it. And as I delighted, guess what? It was much easier to do it than to kind of like, oh, here I am, just obeying God. You know, it's, he changed, and that's just, can you imagine Jesus went to the cross? It was painful, it was hard. But he said, deep down inside, I delight to do your will. Your will for my life is much better than anything I have written for it. And I delight to do it. And if it's difficult, I delight in it. If it's painful, I'll delight in it. I will choose to make this something honorable and something that I'm convinced is better for me, and you deserve it. Verse 11, and every priest stands ministering daily and offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. He's basically saying, you know, what you see done every single day over in that temple, it's not taking away sins. Verse 12 of Hebrews 10. But this man, Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice. Now, I'm saying this man because he had to take on a body. Okay, still God the Son. But God the Son pre-existed before he became human. It was only when he had on a body, because he said, a body you prepare for me, that this sacrifice would be effective. It said, this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins, I love this next word. What's the word after sins in verse 12? Forever. You know, that this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, he sat down at the right hand of God. And you're like, okay, so that meant so much to a Jewish person. Because you couldn't sit down because there was this tension that it was never satisfied. When he sat down at the right hand of his Father, he's saying, I did it once and it stands forever. It's an open account of forgiveness and cleansing available to all mankind that would believe in the Messiah. Ephesians 1:19 says, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, verse 20 of Ephesians 1, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality, power, might, dominion, every name that's named, not only in this age, but also that which is to come. Verse 22, he put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. You can jot these down. Acts 2:34. Remember, he's seated. Acts 2:34. David did not ascend into the heavens, but he says himself, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Colossians 3, verse 1. If then you were raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is sitting at the right hand of God. I love that. It's just everything is right in heaven. And I'm right with heaven. And I can just move from a place of being right. I can be transformed from a place of acceptance. 1 Peter 3:21. It says, there is also an antitype which now saves us, baptism. Not the washing, not removal of filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience towards God through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, angels, authorities, and powers having been made subject to him. So he is at the right hand of God. Verse 13 of Hebrews 10. From that time, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. Remember that in Hebrews 2:8, it says that we don't yet see all things put under him. He conquered, but there's still timing right now. Like death itself, we still die. And one day death will be thrown into the lake of fire. But he's put it, he has the power over death, and he uses it to usher us into heaven. But we don't have to be afraid of death anymore, but Satan is still alive and well. And he's, you know, his judgment is coming. But there's a timing for that. I read today in Daniel, it's really interesting. Let me see, because I don't misrepresent it. Daniel was praying, like, why are we in Babylon? And Jerusalem's all messed up, and how come you're not delivering us? And how come it's just going on and on when we're your people? And the angel came to him, and he said, he explained to him, Gabriel said, 70 weeks are determined for your people and your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, to make reconciliation for iniquity, to bring in righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. And I go, oh, so timing, God's doing something in destruction and timing. Right now, God is giving people a chance to repent. I mean, if everything's under his feet, that's it, we're done. You know, he conquered, but there's a time to repent, a time to receive Christ, a time for people to get, because remember, he's gonna come again without sin. But right now, this is the space that we have to invite people in and to have them put their faith in Christ. Verse 14, for by one offering, you keep seeing this, huh? One offering forever, once and for all, one offering forever. He wants us to get that. Verse 14, for by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. Ladies, if you are in Christ, you are perfected forever by his sacrifice. And I like it too, because it says those who are being sanctified. It's taken care of eternally, but hey, we're still in the process of being changed on this side, huh? It's still coming out. Verse 15, but the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us. And I like that line. The Holy Spirit witnesses to us. Isn't that nice? The Holy Spirit witnesses to us. He talks to us. He says, like a witness declares the things that they see and that they know. And the Holy Spirit does that for us. He tells us things. For after he had said before, verse 16, this is the covenant I'm going to make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts and in their minds. I'm going to write them. How many of us, after we were born again, we had this conviction, this Holy Spirit telling us something is sin we never thought was sin before. We never read it in the law. We just knew it. Because suddenly we had the mind of Christ. And I remember these friends of mine, they were not Christians, and they were celebrating their anniversary of dating. They weren't married yet. And they had gotten this hotel in Los Angeles, and the champagne, and they're going to have a good time and all that. And they were getting ready to go, him and his girlfriend. And his brother sat down with him and said, "Guys, I gave my life to Christ and shared the gospel, and he's changed me." And they both started weeping, and they both said, "Oh, we need the Lord." And they prayed, and they believed in the Lord Jesus, and they got in the car, and they drove, you know, because they had these reservations. And they went inside the hotel room, and they're sitting there, and they looked at each other and go, "We can't sleep with each other tonight. This is sin. Like, this is wrong." And they didn't even know the Bible. They didn't even know the Bible, but the Holy Spirit showed them what was unholy. And that's why we don't have to panic. You ever lead somebody to Christ and go, "How are they going to know?" It's not on you, okay? He dwells in them. It's fine. And there's plenty of mercy for the things they don't get yet. It's okay. But it's one of those things, like even with your kids, they're not reading the Bible. Holy Spirit, show up in that room with them. Holy Spirit, show them this in the tender, convicting, precious, delivering way that you do it. Not with condemnation, but with a sense of deliverance in their lives. And the Holy Spirit, and I mean, how precious is that? And I remember when I was newly saved, I'd be in a Bible study, I go, "I thought that. I felt that. There it is." And I remember I was reading, I had that living Bible, The Way, the green one with the pictures of all the people. And I was sleeping on my mattress on the floor in college, because that's what you do. And I'd be reading my Bible in there at night, and I'd be reading things. I'd go, "Oh my gosh, I felt that that was wrong, but I didn't know it said that." I go, "My gosh, the law in our hearts and in our minds. I will write them." How precious that is. Not on stones of tablet, but on hearts of flesh. And that's why sometimes when we go, I remember when I first got saved, I go, "I don't know anything." I remember being at Bible studies, and everybody's quoting verses and saying things. I'm like, "I don't know, what is that? What is that?" I didn't even know what the books of the Bible were. And they were so like holy, and they looked so good, and they had little crosses, and they looked clean, and I looked all confused. And I remember I was dressed like really, not really modestly, because that's just who I was, and they looked so holy. And I remember I was so confused, I didn't know what to do. But what's neat is that I was clothed in the righteousness of Christ, and I did have the law in my heart and my mind. And I was going to be able to understand. And we have to be patient with people. That God is doing a work in someone's life. Really reinforce that in your brothers and sisters, especially new believers. Tell them that. Say, "Do you know that the Lord has put his law into your heart and in your mind he has written them?" And even if you don't know all the scriptures, if you're quiet enough in your own understanding, the Holy Spirit will witness to you and let you know when something is wrong, because he loves you and wants to deliver you. Verse 17, and he adds, and by the way, this is taken from Jeremiah 31, 33 to 34 in the book of Hebrews. He's quoting from Jeremiah. Verse 17, he adds, "Their sins and their lawless deeds, I'm going to remember them no more." I'm not even into that. I'm writing in their heart and in their mind a new way. They're going to hate the things I hate. They're going to love the things I love. They're going to flee from things that are going to devour them, and they're going to invest in things that are going to transform them, because they have my spiritual DNA now. They're born again. They have the mind of Christ. The love of God has been shed around their heart by the Holy Spirit. They have the temple of the Holy Spirit. I will come in and dwell in them. This is the new, we are the tabernacle of the Holy Spirit now. Amen. Verse 18. Now where there is remission of these, there's no longer an offering for sin. It's done. He did it. We insult him if we think we have to do Jesus plus. But when we rest in what Christ has done, we respond, we remember we are cleansed from our sins. We remember that his law is now in our hearts and in our minds. We walk according to the new nature. We don't have to have penance anymore. And we can move on to the life lived for Christ without being confused or constrained by condemnation or trying to produce a covering. We walk cleansed. We walk holy. We walk thankful. And we give that same mercy to our brothers and sisters who are in the same midst of being sanctified, knowing that that sacrifice we're relying on for our acceptance, they are relying on for their acceptance. Lord, thank you for the truth of your word. It's too good. I just pray that I wouldn't have minimized it or tried to embellish it or anything like that. But Lord, that your plan would stand and your plan would be admired, and that we would not be short-sighted or blind or forget that we've been cleansed from our sins. And it's in the name of the Messiah who gave himself once for all, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen.